this is Message of the Crucifixion, Course in Miracles, Original Edition, Chapter 6, Section 2, Message of the Crucifixion. And we are starting where we left off in the paragraph that says, I've made it perfectly clear. All right, so this is one of my all-time favorite chapters and one of my all-time favorite sections. And it's my go-to section whenever I am feeling attacked, judged, oppressed by anyone or anything. Whenever I'm feeling attacked by something, this is, and I'm feeling the pain and the anger of that, and the fear of that, this is the section I go to. And the reason I go to it is because this is the section that teaches us very, very powerfully and very clearly a whole nother interpretation of attack. A whole nother interpretation of attack and another interpretation of anger. And it is an interpretation of attack that if we take on this and use this particular interpretation of attack, then the attack that we experience coming at us, then we're able to use that experience and experience a transcendence. Truly, we learn how to, from that experience, experience a self that cannot be attacked. Imagine that, okay? From feeling attacked and the anger and the fear that you feel to transcending that, resurrecting from that, realizing, wow, who and what I am can't be attacked. Aha, now I'm free, okay? So our teacher in this is saying, listen, I went through this extreme version of attack, the most extreme version of attack that you can do on Earth. I mean, there's a whole variety, but that's about as extreme as it gets. And I went through this, our teacher says, because an extreme example is a very helpful learning device. And so I went through this extreme example of attack of some children of God upon another so that I could demonstrate once and for all that, number one, you are not a body. And number two, because you're not a body, you cannot be attacked. And so, number three, your anger is never justified. This anger is not justified because who you are can't be attacked. You are not a body. You can't be attacked. Now, and our teacher is saying in this section, I undertook that extreme example of attack to teach you once and for all, to demonstrate it to you so that you wouldn't have to go through something like that only to realize, oh, I'm not a body, I can't be attacked. Gee, I could have learned that without this, right? So our teacher is saying you don't have to go through the experience of being attacked so brutally. You don't have to, because our teacher already did that for us. I'll do the brutal attack thing. I'll do it. I'll show you that obviously that you can't be attacked. A child of God can't be attacked or killed. Okay. So he says you don't have. He says you can let that be the last foolish journey that any child of God ever took. You can now learn that lesson in much less extreme temptations to misperceive. Much less temptation, much less extreme temptation to get upset, to get angry. Okay, so that's what in the beginning, the introduction to this chapter, and then the beginning half of this section. Okay. The other thing that was really important was this section said, for anger to occur, three misperceptions had to have occurred for you to experience any anger at all. And the first thing that had to have occurred, first misperception, is that you have been attacked. That's the first misperception that you had to make to even get angry. The second one was that you were in no way responsible for the attack that you perceived or received. And the third one was that your attack is justified in response, that your defense is, says, those three misinterpretations, misperceptions, distorted thoughts had to have occurred for you to even have gotten angry. Wow. And so, the answer in the healing of anger and all of its poisonous, toxic effects is the remembrance, oh yeah, who and what I am can't be attacked. Uh-huh, okay. I'm sitting here suffering all the effects of this anger. I'm suffering all the toxic effects of this anger for nothing. Because I believe that I've been attacked. Okay? But if I'm tired, when I'm done with all the toxic effects of the anger, then I remind myself, oh yeah, I cannot be attacked. Yes, a body can be attacked. Yes, my self-concept can be attacked, but who and what I am cannot be attacked. And I am responsible for what I'm perceiving and how I'm perceiving it. Okay. All right, so that's some highlights from the last couple of weeks in this section. Okay, any questions on that before we move on? Okay. Okay. All right, so it says that if you are experienced with, I love this sentence, if you respond with anger, then you must be equating yourself with the destructible. Okay. If you're experiencing anger, you're doing what? You are equating yourself with the destructible and are therefore regarding yourself insanely. When you are experiencing anger, okay? And also when you're experiencing anger about the body being destroyed. All right. So that is our, now we're up to speed. Okay, so here goes. Now our teacher goes on, and our teacher says, I have made it perfectly clear that I am like you, and you are like me. Okay? Good thing to remember. And it says, but our fundamental equality can be demonstrated only through joint decision. You want to know that you are equal with your teacher who got killed and then did not die? Do you want to know that you're equal with your teacher? It comes only through joint decision. We got to make the same decision our teacher made. Our teacher experienced that resurrection because of a decision. Okay? You want to experience a rebirth or resurrection from what seems to be crucifying you right now? That comes from a decision. That comes from making the same decision that our teacher made. About what? About what attack is. And the same decision that our teacher made about what we are, what I am, okay? Then it says, you might remember, however, when you do choose to react with anger, that I was persecuted as the world judges, and I did not share this evaluation for myself. And because I didn't share this evaluation of myself as persecuted, I did not share it, I did not strengthen it. I therefore offered a different interpretation of attack, says our teacher. I therefore offered a different interpretation of attack and a different interpretation of attack, which I do want to share with you. And if you will believe this different interpretation of attack, then you will help me to teach this different interpretation of attack. All right. Okay. And he says, he earlier in the section, he says, listen, you need this different interpretation of attack. You need it to assist you in your being a teacher of God or your being a teacher of truth. If there's one thing that a teacher of truth really, 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 really needs, it's a different interpretation of attack. Why? Because what happens when we, as teacher of God, start teaching the truth and saying, love, 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 love. Only love is real. What happens when anyone starts teaching truth?
You're likely to be attacked.
Yeah, you're likely to be attacked. You know, that's not the, You know, the world isn't really keen on that. You know, or the ego, wherever you meet with the ego. Okay? So, as teachers of truth, people who are here to demonstrate only love is real, only love is powerful, this has a lot to offer to our role as teachers. So we also need a different interpretation of attack so that when we experience what appears to be attack, then we can make the same decision our teacher did and go, aha, I cannot be attacked. My anger is not justified. I am responsible for this. What I am can't be attacked. And so in my defenselessness, my safety lies. And our teacher here is saying, look, I need your help to teach this. I don't know if you've noticed, but we live in a world of attack. This is the attack world, right? And so our teacher is saying, look, I really need you to help me teach this lesson. What lesson? The different interpretation of attack. Wow. Think of the freedom that we will experience emotionally. Think of the emotional power and freedom that we'll experience when we share that new interpretation of attack. I mean, think about how free you would be if you knew that who you were couldn't be attacked. You would be so free, you'd be so happy. You would be walking the world, experiencing relationships with such joy, with such freedom, when we know that we can't be attacked, when we share the new interpretation of attack that our teacher is offering to us. Wow, that's what I would like to have. Okay, so, and then our teacher's also saying too that our teacher demonstrated what occurs within you when you interpret attack like our teacher did. When you're perceiving yourself as being attacked and you're tempted by anger and you apply the truth and you apply that reinterpretation of attack, then what happens is you experience the same thing our teacher did. You experience a rebirth. You experience a transcendence where your old self falls away and you rise into the experience of an invulnerable self. Wow. So that's what's on the other side of this experience where you're feeling attacked. Whether it's, you know, being where you feel like your body's being attacked, or you feel like you're being attacked by the world, or attacked by the toxicity of the environment in the world, or whatever. Anytime you're feeling attacked and you share that same decision to reinterpret being attacked to the realization of, hey, who I am can't be attacked, you resurrect from a self-concept that was always afraid of everything, felt vulnerable all the time, felt afraid, felt angry, vulnerable all the time. You resurrect into a being that is free, isn't afraid, isn't feeling vulnerable all the time, knows its true strength. So he gave us the perfect demonstration of what happens when you reinterpret attack. Okay, so does that sound practical in this crazy world where we always seem to be attacked? Okay, so then our teacher says, we have said before, as you teach, so shall you learn. Now, what does that mean? That means if you react as if you are persecuted, then guess what you're doing? You are teaching persecution. Uh-huh. But persecution is not a lesson which the children of God should want to teach if they are to realize their own freedom. I want to realize my own freedom, my own happiness. Okay. Well, then you may not want to be teaching persecution. You can't be teaching persecution. Look what's being done to me. And also be teaching freedom. You can't teach both at the same time. You can't teach, ooh, look at my infinite potential, and then turning around and going, look what they're doing to me, look what they're making me feel. You can't teach both of those at the same time. Interesting. So then it says, rather teach your own perfect immunity. I love it. What am I supposed to teach besides look what they did to me? Your own perfect immunity. I love that. Which is the truth in you. And know that your own perfect immunity cannot be assailed. Okay? So if I'm not going to be teaching that I can be attacked by you know who and you know what, if I'm not going to be teaching that something's being done to me from outside of myself, what can I be teaching? What's the alternative? The alternative is teach your own perfect immunity, which is the truth in you. Wow. And do what? And know that it cannot be assailed. Wow. So that's what we're supposed to be teaching. That's what we could be teaching in place of, look what they're doing to me. Okay? Isn't that nice? Oh, in this situation where I'm really feeling attacked right now, okay, what I'd rather demonstrate here is my own perfect immunity, which is the truth in me and which cannot be assailed. Okay, great. Now what do I do? Okay, now here's what you do next. Don't try to protect your own perfect immunity yourself. Don't try to protect your own invulnerability yourself. Don't try to protect it. Don't try to protect it yourself. So it's really just a realization. The truth in me is my own perfect immunity, which cannot be attacked. I cannot be attacked. And so I don't need to protect myself. I don't need to defend myself. I don't need to protect myself. I don't need to defend. I don't need to protect. All I need to do is do what? Is demonstrate my own perfect immunity. So I don't demonstrate that I can't be attacked by defending myself. Hey, you can't attack me. I'm the holy child of God himself. Perfect. I'm spirit. You can't attack me. So don't try to protect it yourself. Okay? So our teacher is teaching us how to make that same decision that our teacher made that gave our teacher all power in earth and heaven, all power over the fearful mind. Our teacher is, this is how I did it. This is how I did it. This is how you could do it too, where you can have all power over your fear. And have all power over your guilt and all power over what seems to limit and hurt you. You make the same decision that your teacher made. Okay. This is how you do it.
Is there a workbook lesson that says, when I'm defended, I'm attacked?
Mm-hmm. When I defend myself, I am attacked. Yes, exactly. And in my defenselessness, my safety lies. And so really, in every situation where we're experiencing ourselves being attacked, it's really an opportunity to demonstrate our own resurrection, our own rebirth, our own freedom from what seems to limit us or what seems to attack us. It's that chance, come again. Oh, here's my chance, come again. Right? Okay. So notice I'm demonstrating my own perfect immunity, but I'm not protecting it myself. I'm demonstrating it, but I'm not defending myself. Okay. Now, any questions on that? Anybody have any experiences in the last week where they felt attacked by anything? Anyone? Yes, I have felt attacked by Earth. Okay. Being in a body on planet Earth sometimes feels like one big giant attack. Wow. Truly. Okay, that's the way that it feels. Because the world, the Course says the world originally was an attack thought. That's where the world came from. An attack thought. A thought that I could be attacked by something outside of myself that could have power over me, me created by love, me created by God. That's what the world is. It is that belief. So you can see how important that lesson is. I mean, truly, this is the lesson here. This is the lesson here. That's why it was such a, important lesson that our teacher taught. Okay, so. Okay.
It kind of goes back to Jesus getting strength in his crucifixion because he knew it wasn't real.
Yes.
The attack wasn't real.
Yes.
The people that were attacking him were not real. Yeah. The world in which they were attacking him was not real.
Right.
And so it's that premise, I think, that you're always, this book is always saying, go back to.
That's.
And that makes it a little bit easier.
Exactly.
To just decide to be immune to being attacked by anyone and consistently asking for the voice for God to help you with that.
Exactly. Like you were saying, ask for your teacher's help in making that same decision to see it correctly. Exactly. And yes, the attack isn't real, the body isn't real, the people attacking you isn't real, but the people are the children of God. They are your spirit siblings. They are real. Who they are is real. Who you are is real. Okay, so remember, it was saying, yes, one body can attack another body. We're not saying that bodies don't attack or can't be attacked. We're not saying that. It's just saying that what you are, who you are, can't be attacked. And what's true in you is your own perfect immunity. What's true in you is the spirit that can't be touched. Can't be touched. Okay. All right. So then it says, you are not asked to be crucified, which was my part of my own teaching contribution. You are merely asked to follow my example in the face of much less extreme temptations to misperceive and to not accept them falsely as justifications for anger. Okay? So our teacher is very clearly saying that whole thing where my body was attacked, brutally attacked, and then crucified literally, you're not asked to do that. You're not asked to be attacked by the world brutally and then resurrect. He said that was my teaching part. He says all you're being asked to do is to follow my example in the face of much less extreme temptation to be angry. Okay, so when you are experiencing a temptation to be angry, okay, think about the last time you experienced feeling angry at something or somebody, and then compare that to what our teacher went through. And that's what our teacher is saying to do. I want you, when you're upset, you're about to be angry at you know who, and you know what, I just want you to do what? Follow my example in much less extreme temptation to be angry. Okay? I know that you think you have every justification to feel angry that they showed up late. I get that. Okay. And, you know, I would like you to do a little comparison between what you are tempted to feel angry about and what I was tempted to feel angry about. Do a little comparison right there, and then follow my example and say, I cannot be attacked. The truth in me is my own perfect immunity, and I'm not going to defend myself. I'm not going to defend myself. Okay, so that's all our teacher is saying to do. Do a little comparison.
So here, he's telling us in the whole martyr concept,
and the whole sacrifice concept are misinterpretation.
Thank you.
Of what he was trying to teach us.
Beautiful. Thank you. The whole martyr and, what did you say, victim?
Sacrifice.
Sacrifice, victim concept is a misinterpretation.
Old ideas in a lot of religions.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, you know, that whole crucifixion story has become the reason that the ego gives for, or the demonstration that what love and what God demands of those that love God is sacrifice. You know, that's the story that the ego holds up and goes, look at what God demanded of his favorite son. So what do you think he demands of you? You know, so it's that whole story is now used by the ego to see. We see what love demands sacrifice. See? Love demands sacrifice. So if you want love, you too are going to have to sacrifice.
And feel guilty because...
And feel guilty.
And dying on the cross for us.
Exactly. Exactly. So that's why this is such an important lesson, because that whole crucifixion story has been, it's like the ego has used it as its, like, its crowning demonstration that love demands sacrifice, right? And so now we associate love with fear. Now we associate love with attack. And so now we're afraid of love, and the ego's like, yes, all right. Now, the children of God associate love with sacrifice and guilt. And so now they associate love and attack. Yay! Woohoo! That's the ego's crowning achievement. Now we're all terrified of love. And now we seek fear, thinking it's love. The ego's like, yeah. And so anyone who's like, oh, we've got it all backwards. We got it all backwards. It's only love that doesn't demand sacrifice. It's only love that doesn't attack. And when we remember, oh yeah, we have it all backwards, that's when the Course says that the ego sees us as the enemy. That's when the ego looks at us and goes, oh no, you didn't. Oh no, you didn't. Right? That's why this is a particularly important lesson to help us in our role as teachers of love. Okay? All right.
So you think maybe to bring that even to a bigger step, the people that were crucifying Jesus, if he could, I think what he's asking us to do is what he was doing. You are a perfect child of God, mm-hmm. God in whom my Creator is well pleased. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I think if you could truly live that with anybody you had grievances with, imagine what would be coming back to you.
Yes.
You would always be feeling that about yourself.
Yes.
And that would make you amenable.
Exactly. Absolutely. I mean, imagine what, if for one day you experienced your own perfect immunity, where you knew you couldn't be attacked. You knew you couldn't be attacked. You knew you couldn't be killed. I mean, what would that day be like? What would your relationships be like if you knew that? Wow. What would it be like to be in your body if you knew that? Where you weren't experiencing the effects of fear and anger and guilt in your body.
Could be a good day.
Yeah. I mean, truly. You know, your body would be in its optimal, healthy, powerful, strong state. Your relationships would be supremely joyous. Your life would be unending abundance. If you knew you couldn't be attacked, if you were experiencing your own perfect immunity, wow, you would be free, and you would be happy, and you would be rich in the truest sense of the word. Absolutely. And you would experience your relationships as the Course calls them the temples of the Holy Spirit. They would be like a temple to love. Wow. You'd be so radiant, you'd be so healthy, you'd be free. Wow. And you would be radiant if you knew you couldn't be attacked. If you had accepted your own perfect immunity. Now, the way that you learn your own perfect immunity, the way you learn that you can't be attacked, is notice how it says you demonstrate it. So it's almost like our teacher got it when he demonstrated it. You know, that was when he was like, aha, it is accomplished, right? So, you know, it goes like this. I practice it, I demonstrate it, and then I get it. Because once I don't defend myself, once I don't protect my innocence and my immunity, I don't protect it myself. Once I don't defend myself with attack, once I go, oh, I cannot be attacked, and I make that decision, then I experience the reality of that. So, do you see? First you demonstrate it, then you get it. That's what the Course says. You teach it, then you get it.
Do you think that this is implying, then, you know, mostly we think attack produces defense, but right. What this says, defense produces attack.
Thank you.
But then does immunity produce safety?
Yes, it does. Okay. I like that. It's cool how my defense, we think that their attack produces my defense. We think their attack produces my attack or defense. When it really, the truth is exactly what you said. It's my defense that produces the attack. That's the part, that's why he says, remember that you are responsible. When you're feeling angry, remember this. I cannot be attacked. I cannot be attacked. What was the second one? Cannot be attacked.
The attack was not justified.
Yes. Oh, yes. And the my anger is, oh, I am in no way responsible. I'm in no way. So, yes. Yeah, so, in other words, the experience of being attacked means that I was defending myself somehow. I was attacking first. That's why I'm seeing it. Which also means that as I demonstrate, which means extend my own perfect immunity, then I experience safety. So how do you experience safety in the world? How do you experience real safety? Well, it doesn't come from putting more locks on your door, more locks on your heart. It comes from recognizing your own perfect immunity. Who I am is spirit. Who I am can't be attacked. There's this this prayer in the workbook that puts this into action. It says, I am the holy child of God himself. I cannot suffer. I cannot be in pain. I cannot suffer loss, nor fail to do all that freedom asks or requires. And I remember when I first read that, I was like, wait a minute, how am I supposed to say that? I am the perfect child of God himself. I cannot suffer. I cannot be in pain. I cannot suffer loss, nor fail to do all that love asks. It's like, what does it mean? Why is he asking us to say that? But now I understand. That prayer is how you teach and demonstrate your own perfect immunity. That's how you experience the truth about yourself, the perfect immunity about yourself. You got to tell yourself the truth. That's how it happens. You got to tell yourself the truth and tell it to yourself over and over and over and over and over and over again, even in the face of what seems like an attack, and then you will demonstrate it. All right. Well.
So this, like all the fear things we learned, if you hear it over and over and over, you will end up believing it.
That's exactly right. And if you'll say it to yourself in the appearance of being attacked, if you'll say it then you will demonstrate it. Then you will experience the triumph of love over fear. The triumph of truth over limitation. All right. So then it says there can be no justification for the unjustifiable. And what was the unjustifiable? Getting angry when the body is destroyed. Getting angry when a body is attacked. That was the unjustifiable. It says there can be no justification for the unjustifiable or anger. Do not believe there is, and do not teach that there is justification for anger. Do not teach that there is justification for unjustifiable anger. Anger means that you are equating yourself with the destructible. Anger means I'm equating myself with something that can be destroyed. Wow. This is that deep to hear that that's what anger really means. I'm equating myself with something that can be destroyed, which means I'm equating myself with the body. But he's saying, don't teach that there's any justification for anger, for the unjustifiable. He says, instead of that, remember always that what you believe, you will teach. Which means, if you'll believe with me, then we will become equal as teachers. Aha! Are you saying, I could become equal with that teacher? I can become equal with that teacher? I will become equal as a teacher to that teacher? Really? That's interesting. That's quite a promise, don't you think? If you will do what? He says, if you will believe with me, then you will become as equal as a teacher with me. You will become equal as teachers. Wow. So how do we become equal as a teacher with our teacher? Believe with our teacher. Okay. What did our teacher believe? Our teacher believed that he could not be attacked, and that who and what he is and was couldn't be assailed, even if his body was killed. So that's what we're learning how to believe. We're learning how to believe with our teacher. What did our teacher believe? Okay, that's what we're gonna practice believing. And for us, it's gonna be practice for a while.
With much less extreme.
With much, much less extreme temptation to become angry. I love that. Just, you know, when you're tempted to feel angry, just do that little, quick little comparison and contrast test. Let's see. I'm upset because why? I'm upset because so-and-so said such-and-such. Okay. I'm really tempted to be angry. Okay, now let's see. Now, what did our teacher go through? What was our teacher's temptation to be upset? Okay, all right. Okay, all right. Just do the little contrast and comparison test and then believe with our teacher. Oh yeah, I can't be attacked. It doesn't matter what they say about me. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that they left me. It doesn't matter that they judged me. It doesn't matter because I can't be attacked. They don't even know who I am. They can't get to me. They can't get to me. No ego can get to me. That's how we're being asked to practice. And all it takes is a few times of practicing a little bit like that to experience the transcendental power that comes from that kind of practice. That's why we're here. That is why we're here on Planet Attack. Our last episode on Planet Attack, everybody was seeing themselves as being attacked and seeing their anger as being justifiable and their defense being righteous. And war reigned throughout the land.
It could be a powerful teacher, I was thinking of, as you realize that someone's perceptions of you doesn't change your reality.
That's right.
You will also learn that your perceptions don't make reality either.
Thank you. Yeah. And there's the end of your guilt. I mean, let's say you had an unloving thought about somebody. You know, if your next thought was, oh, yeah, you know, and my ego doesn't even see them. My ego can't even touch them. Then no guilt. I just had an unloving attack thought. I remembered the truth. No guilt. No guilt. And then when there's no guilt at my unloving thought, then guess what? Then I don't unconsciously attract punishment from the world. Because where you know, of course, says guilt is an unconscious request for punishment. And the Course says you cannot have an unloving thought about anyone. You cannot have an unloving thought, an attack thought, and not experience guilt. It's like, okay, wake up call. Wake up call. The ego wants to teach us that, oh, you can attack all day long, honey, and never experience the effects of that attack. That's what the ego is trying to teach us. And that's why the ego wants, above all else, for us to feel separate and to think that we're separate. Because it wants us to believe, it needs us to believe, the ego needs us to believe that you can attack in safety. Well, I can just judge them and judge them all day long because it's them, it's them, it's them, and escape all effects of that attack. Why? Because they're not me. So I can attack them without attacking myself. Because they're not me. That's the ego's whole game. That's its whole strategy. Get us to feel separate so that we'll believe that we can attack in safety without hurting ourselves. So, thank you, Jim. This is perfect in the reverse, too. Yeah. You know, so that even though you have an unloving thought, and you always know when you have an unloving thought because you feel a stab of pain. You feel a stab of some kind. You know, love doesn't stab. So so you know you got fear because you feel a little stab. And when you feel, and when you realize that you have judged or attacked, then remember, oh yeah, my ego cannot touch them. You can't, they are perfectly immune from my misperception, from my attack, from my judgment. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God that they are perfectly immune to my judgment and my attack. Thank God. Thank you, God. Because that means I'm still innocent. And now I don't need to attract punishment from the world in the form of shit happening, right? That is, oh, that's my unconscious guilt attracting punishment so I can feel innocent again. All right, thank you for saying that, Jim. Okay, how are we doing on time? All right. So then it says, oh, I love it, it says, your resurrection is your reawakening. So he says, my resurrection came from being brutally murdered. Okay. But your resurrection is not going to be like mine, says our teacher. Your resurrection is just your reawakening. Love it. And then our teacher says, I am the model for rebirth, but rebirth itself is merely the dawning of on your minds of what is already in your minds. What is our rebirth? The dawning on our minds of what's already in our minds. Uh-huh. Now, what is already in our minds that's going to dawn upon us? Well, our own perfect immunity. Our spiritual essence that can't be attacked, that's invulnerable, because it's spirit. It's not physical. That's our rebirth. Oh, what's within me can't be attacked. What's within me can't die. What's within me can't suffer. What's within me can't lose or experience pain, or suffer loss, or fail to accomplish anything loving. Ah, that's what's already in my mind. Who knew? That's our resurrection. Was it our resurrection? Is our reawakening. Nice. So, you know, our teacher's like, yeah, I experienced the resurrection this way, but that was my special part. That's not yours. All you've got to do is remember what's already in your mind and let it dawn upon your mind. That's your resurrection. That's your rebirth. Nice. Because, you know, check it out. Anything that feels, any way that we're suffering, our problems, those are our crucifixions. That's the way we're crucifying ourselves, right? Whatever the problem is, that's the way I believe I'm being crucified. That's the crucifixion and the attack that I believe that I have to endure, you know, to be holy or to be loved. Wow. And me making the same decision that my teacher made, which is to demonstrate that I can't be attacked, is the way that I resurrect from that personal crucifixion. Oh, the way I'm crucifying myself is I'm crucifying myself today with the flu. Well, today I'm crucifying myself with bank account problems. Well, today I'm crucifying myself through you-know-who. Our problems are all the ways that we are doing our own crucifixion trip. And it's also, every one of them, the opportunity to experience our own resurrection, our own rebirth, and our own reawakening from our own attack.
It's kind of interesting that our awakening, it's not a learning, it's a recognition.
Yes, a dawning. Yeah. Like that, exactly. It's a dawning.
We can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
Like so many other things.
Exactly. All right. Is everybody seeing how this can be applied to anything that you have been going through recently, any of your own personal special crucifixions? Yeah. Okay. All right. Anybody have any questions about how to apply it specifically to your own special crucifixion? All of our crucifixions trips are so special. I'm sure nobody else experiences this. I'm sure everybody else has this down. I'm sure nobody else goes through the financial stuff like I go through. I'm sure everybody else has got the relationship thing down. I'm sure everybody else has got the health thing down, and they're not making the kind of mistakes I'm making.
So one way I feel crucified a lot is lack of time.
Uh-huh. Mm. Attacked by time.
I do.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anybody relate to that one? Yeah.
And mm-hmm. I'm responsible for this.
Yes.
We haven't really talked too much about that in the last few...
About time?
No, about
being responsible
for mm-hmm. the last few sessions. I mean, we address it, but we don't go into it. Maybe we mm-hmm. I don't remember if this chapter goes into that or not, mm-hmm. but that might be helpful as we work through mm-hmm. this, is mm-hmm. I've got to be attracting this.
Yes.
Again and again and again.
Indeed. Exactly. And until we demonstrate, until we start applying the different interpretation of attack.
Can you hurry up, please?
Speaking of time. Yes, until we start applying the new interpretation of attack, then guess what we keep experiencing?
Time.
Attack. By whatever, you know, and I mean, you know, what just crossed my mind was all the attack thoughts I've had about, all the attack thoughts I've had toward people about how they've wasted my time, and all of a sudden I just saw this connection. I've had so many, so much anger at people, you wasted my time, I just wasted 2 years with you. I've had that grievance. Oops. And then just all of a sudden, like, click, 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 and, you know, oh, I don't have enough time. I'm wasting time. I'm feeling attacked by time. Yeah, because you've attacked people with time.
I think you chose a particularly appropriate example there. It hit me that's great. Since we choose how we spend every minute of every day ourselves, we make all the decisions about time,
yes,
and you feel attacked by it. That's a perfect example of what we do with everything.
Exactly. And we could only feel attacked by time or feel like there's not enough time, or we waste guilt over wasting time, that's my big one, if we've been misusing time. You know, and so, you know, we've been misusing time for attack. We've been using our time for attack. We've been using our time for the ego, for fear. So no wonder we feel like we don't have enough time, feel guilty that we wasted time, or I don't have enough time, or they're wasted, they've used up my time. Like those 5 years I just gave to you, I'd like them back, please. Does that speak to...
No, that's an interesting point.
Yeah.
You have using too much time for attack.
Yeah, misusing time.
Stop misusing time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you start using time on behalf of the eternal, something that never ends, then you have another experience of time. Like, oh, I have plenty of time. Yes?
Time is my friend. I leave it to the Holy Spirit to use my time because He knows how to use it so that not one thing will be left wanting.
Beautiful. Thank you. I join with you in that. Mm-hmm. I join with that decision.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
For me, guilt is triggered in my body in so many different areas.
Yes.
And so much attack has got to do with that. Mm-hmm. And time, too. Guilty because somebody else is not on time. I'm feeling guilty because I'm not on time.
Right.
Or is there so many ways that the Course of
Miracles... Wasting time.
Wasting time. But the Course of Miracles brings it back to, you know, the sole purpose of the miracle workers accepting atonement for themselves.
Yes.
And that is the relinquishment of guilt. So anytime
yes.
at all, you've got guilt going on, which happens all of the time.
Yep.
It happens with attack. It happens with feeling attacked or projecting attack.
Mm-hmm.
And then again, you can feel that. For me... I can really feel that something's not going right just with the cells in my body, which
yes.
is the guilt thing.
Yes.
So then I know that I've decided wrongly and I can choose again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. The Course in Miracles is just revolutionary in that it is the thing that taught us how to recognize the ego state of mind. How to recognize when you are thinking with the ego. How to recognize when you are thinking with your ego.
All the time.
Yeah, exactly. And it's genius, you know, in that it taught us how to recognize that. That is of a priceless value. You know, because think about it, before the course, I didn't know the difference between when I was... misperceiving or when I was perceiving correctly. I didn't know the difference. I just thought if I was thinking it, then it was true. I didn't have any way to discern whether I was mistaken or having correct perception. I had no way to tell the difference. And so I had no real guide to peace. I had no real guide. And so... But now that the Course has taught me how to tell the difference between when I'm thinking with my ego and when I'm thinking with spirit, now I have a guide and a direction and a map to follow that really can lead me to the life I want to have, you know, where I'm experiencing heaven on earth. I'm so grateful to the Course for that. So grateful for that. So grateful. It finally gave us a real path to follow. All right. So then it says, beautiful, I am the model for rebirth, but rebirth itself is merely the dawning on your minds of what is already in your mind. Now, God placed what's already in your mind, Himself, which means that what God placed in your mind is true, forever. Our teacher says, I believed in it, what God placed in our minds, and therefore made it forever true for me, says our teacher. I believed in what God put in my mind, and and I believed in it. I therefore made it forever true for me. Then our teacher asks us for help. Our teacher then says, please help me to teach it to our equals, brothers means equals, in the name of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of love. But first, believe that it's true or you will teach amiss. Okay, so if you are going through something that feels like a crucifixion, if you feel right now in your life in some area that you feel dead or asleep or somehow like this, the way to experience a rebirth in your life, woo, I'm reborn. The way to experience a rebirth, he says, is to believe in what God placed in your mind that is eternal. What is in my mind that's eternal? What is in my mind that's true forever? What is in my mind that's true forever? What is in my mind? Discover it for yourself. Believe that it's true for you. And then you will be able to help your teacher to teach it to the world. Wow. And you will experience a rebirth. Okay, so let's just, practically speaking, let's just say you're going through what feels like a crucifixion right now. Or let's go, or maybe in some area of your life you just feel dead. Just like no energy, just feels dead, static. Your rebirth comes from going, okay, I'm experiencing right now really sucks. It hurts. I just feel dead inside. This feels like I'm being crucified. Okay, all right, I could think about that all day long, but I'm not going to. I'm going to focus on what God placed in my mind that's eternal, that's true forever. Let me think about that for a few minutes today instead of how this situation is crucifying me. Let me just quiet my mind and say, okay, I'd like to experience what you put in my mind, God, that's true forever. What is it that's in my mind that God put in my mind and that is true forever? What is that? That is what will produce the experience of I was dead and now I am reborn. I was feeling dead in my life. I was feeling dead in this area of my life. And now I'm experiencing a rebirth. Wow. Because if you remember what's in your mind that's true forever, meaning cannot die, cannot end, then how upset are you going to be by what seems to be happening to you from without? I'm upset about what's happening because I think it has power to kill something inside of me. That's why I'm afraid of it. That's why I feel attacked by it. That's why I'm scared. But if I remember that there's something in me that cannot affect, that's true forever, that cannot die, then not only am I no longer upset, but now I'm experiencing a rebirth of my power, a rebirth of my creativity, a rebirth of my freedom, of my joy, my abundance, and my liveness.
And this book is full of examples of what is true.
Yes.
For eternity.
Exactly.
That's in our mind.
Thank you for saying that.
That we are, that we have perfect immunity, that we have perfect innocence that's given to you by God, that we are loved and loving and lovable.
Yes.
It's just on and on
and on. And on. This whole book is, I'm going to tell you what God put in your mind that is true forever for you. For instance, your own perfect innocence, your own perfect immunity from all attack forever. Okay? Your own total completion, where you have everything forever. That you are wholly loving and wholly lovable forever.
That joy and peace are our inheritance.
Yes. Yeah. You have joy. You have peace. You have eternal life forever. You have perfect completion. You have everything you want, everything you need, all the time, forever. And it's in your mind. You have all peace, all power, all joy, all innocence, all immunity, all abundance, all life, forever. Woo!
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Wait. And it's in your mind forever. Meaning no bad situation, no bad relationship, no bad financial situation, no illness, not even death can touch it. Now, what if you were to focus on that for 5 minutes? 5 minutes when you are tempted to feel terrified and angry at what seems to be happening to you from without. What if you were like, oh, I'm in hell. Oh, okay, well, 5 minutes. I'm going to focus on what's in my mind that God put there that's true forever, that I cannot lose. 5 minutes. What do you think would happen in 5 minutes? Whew, rebirth. Where that thing seemed to be pulling you down, having the power to do you in. The next thing you know, you have rebirth, you're reborn from it. Wow. And then once, he said, our teacher is saying, please help me. I need your help. That's interesting. This all-powerful teacher, amazing teacher, all-powerful, is asking for your help to teach it. And then the way that you teach it, I love it. He says, the way you teach that is you do what? You first believe that it's true for you. So in the situation where you seem to be being crucified right now, first practice believing that this truth is true for you. For 5 minutes, practice believing that no matter what is happening outside of you, that it cannot touch the holiness, the innocence, the power, the eternal life in your mind. He says, that will enable you to teach it to the world. Wow. Believe it's true for you, you will teach it to the world. And not only that, but you'll be equal as a teacher to that teacher. That's pretty awesome. How'd you like to be equal to that teacher? Seems like that'd be pretty cool.
How could you aspire for anything?
Exactly. What is a loftier life goal than that?
Right.
You know, I want to be that high quality, that radiant, that loving, that powerful of a teacher of love on planet Earth. That's what I want. Can anybody name a goal that might be higher than that? I'm just curious. Anything that could be higher than that? Anything that could produce greater joy, greater abundance? Being a teacher of love like that in the world today. What could be better? Of a function, of a purpose. What could give you more of a sense of purpose and joy and aliveness? That's why we're here. We're here to teach only love, because that is what we are. So that's your only lesson. Teach only love. Okay, what am I supposed to do today? I'm supposed to teach only love, because that's what I am. Okay, let's see. How am I going to do it today with my kid? Okay. How am I going to do it with you-know-who? All right. How am I going to do it on my job? Okay. How am I going to do it even though I have the flu? Or how am I going to do it even though I have cancer? Teach only love, because that is what you are. What's my job here? Teach only love, because that is what I am. All right. At least I know what I'm supposed to do. And I love it. If you remember what your purpose is, then all the means will be provided and you don't have to figure out anything else. All the means will be provided and you don't have to figure out anything else. Okay, in this situation, I don't really know exactly what's going on. I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do, but I do remember that I'm supposed to teach, which means demonstrate only love, because that's what I am. Okay, great. That's it. Now, all the means are provided, then the spirit goes, okay, speak to this person, then I want you to go over there, and then I want you to speak to that person, then I want you to do this, and then I want you to do that, and then I want you to go over here, and then I want you to speak to this person, I want you to go talk to that person, this is what I want you to say, and then I want you to go over here, and this is what I want you to do. Spirit comes in with all the specifics, very specific, precision, precise specifics. That's not our part. That's Spirit's part once we remember what our one purpose is in every situation, which is to teach our own perfect immunity. Teach that who you are cannot be attacked. Teach only love because that's what you are. And that what's inside your mind is a love that is forever true. Period. All right. Okay, well, that seems easy enough, right? That seems simple enough, don't you think? Yes, except for when it comes to you-know-who. Or yes, except for when it comes to that situation. All right. So, any yes buts? Any questions? Any yes? Well, you don't know my partner. Yes, but you haven't met my mother. Any of those? Any yes buts there? All right. Any questions about how to apply this?
I have one question.
Okay.
Situation where there's a group of people, and in this case it will be my family.
Okay, let's just say.
Arguing about this and that about politics, what's okay. going on in politics.
Oh, let's just
not,
say.
And yeah. not wanting to engage in that or strengthen any of those ideas.
Yes.
And keeping my mouth shut is the best.
I like this hypothetical situation yeah. that you're bringing up. Thank you. Yes,
it's
okay.
difficult to keep my mouth shut.
I understand. I have that similar temptation to justify the unjustifiable.
And yet, if I could, what could I be telling myself that's aligned with what's true always and not reinforcing what's going on around me?
Nice. Okay, well, what given what we heard tonight and then last week, what do you think? What do you think could be something? Let's just say you and your family sit around, start talking politics, arguing starts, and you feel that tension, that anger rising, that temptation to be angry. Mm-hmm. What could you do differently in this situation, given what we heard?
Remember that anger is never justified. I think skipping ahead a few chapters. The one that seems to work for me, if I can remember it in time, is that every loving thought is true, everything else is a call for love.
Nice, very good. Yeah, that's the one I've been working with lately. Every loving thought is true, everything else is a call for love. Yes. And in my defenselessness, my safety lies. Or, how about this one? There's nothing at stake.
It's true.
There's nothing at stake. I don't have to defend my political position, which I'm sure is right. By the way, even though it's right, I don't have to defend. There's nothing at stake. I saw a great meme on Facebook that was saying, It listed all the political candidates that are running for president right now. It had all their pictures. And then it said something to the effect of, it doesn't matter who wins, happiness is still all up to you. And I was like, thank you. Note to self, it doesn't matter who wins. You know, happiness is still an inside job. It still comes from you going, okay, what's in my mind that's forever loving and forever true? What's in this situation, what is in my mind that's forever loving and forever true? That's the only source of happiness still. It doesn't matter who the president is. It really doesn't. And we should all know that by now. You know, who among us can say, well, you know, I really am happier because so-and-so is president. You know, when so-and-so was the president, I was really happy.
No.
I mean, who could say that?
Because they don't. Well, they don't make your decisions.
Anyway, exactly. It's not the president who's making the decision. It's us who's deciding on the political system, you know, the government system that we are deciding on, who we vote or not vote for. Or whether we look within and say, hey, what's inside my mind that's forever loving and forever true that I can call upon and remember right now? In place of attacking back.
Well, and Jesus never got pulled into politics.
He never did.
Ever.
He said, render unto Caesar's.
All that in your answer.
Never did. Never did.
No way. He said, I'm not, don't pull me into that.
He said, don't pull me into that.
He didn't say it like that.
Exactly.
He said it in a loving way.
Exactly.
I'm not here politically. I'm not here to throw this person over or take over.
That's right.
I'm not here to be the king. I'm not here to be a Messiah either.
Not here to be a king or a Messiah.
Nope. Was only to teach God's messages. And
exactly.
The Father's message.
And that message was that that what God has given to all of God's creations, God has given to every living being and put it in their minds forever. God has placed this forever love, this forever power inside the mind of every living being, every living thing, and put it there forever. That is where your source, where the source of happiness and aliveness comes from. That's where it comes from. Doesn't matter who's the president. Doesn't matter what the people around you are saying or doing. Doesn't even matter what you're saying or doing. So light up. All right, how about we stop here for tonight? Okay. All right. So let's do our financial expression of appreciation. Thank you guys for your, thank you guys. And thank you guys for who are listening, who are watching on the internet. Thank you for joining us and thank you for your support as well.
Thank you, Anna.
You're welcome. And don't forget to go to my website, annakujawa.com. To learn more about my holistic counseling practice and schedule a miracle psychotherapeutic session with me. I appreciate you guys. All right, so now we are going to do the integration meditation, which is what I always do at the end of my sessions, where we take these ideas and we apply them. All right. So go ahead and just close your eyes and take a breath. And just tune into how you feel right now. And just breathe it in. How does it feel to have heard these ideas? And how does it feel to have heard these ideas with others? I want you to bring to your awareness a situation recently that you are feeling yourself being crucified in. You're feeling attacked by something or someone. I want you to see that situation or that person in your mind's eye. I want you to take note of how it felt, how that perception felt. How does it feel to feel attacked, feel crucified by something? Take note of any anger that was in the perception. And then take note, too, of the story you were telling yourself about your perception of being attacked? What was the story you were telling yourself about who was attacking you, why they were attacking you, what was attacking you? And take note of how that felt, how that perception felt. How did that story feel in your mind, in your heart, in your body? Beautiful. And in your mind's eye, I want you to just step back a pace from that situation, a little distance. And now, stepping back, let's go ahead and ask. Ask the question, what is it that God has placed in my mind that is forever true? That is always true in all space, in all time, every situation and every relationship. What is it that God has placed in my mind that's still forever true in all space and time? Ask to be reminded of that. Ask yourself, what is still true about me? What is still true about me that my Creator established? Divine indweller, my teacher within, remind me of my own perfect immunity, which is forever true within me now. Show me the truth that I cannot be attacked. Please show me the truth that I cannot suffer loss. Divine indweller, please show me the truth that I remain exactly as I was created by God. Holy loving, holy lovable, complete, sinless, immortal. Immortal spirit, perfect sinlessness, wholly complete, still whole, only love, perfect, free. Show me that I still remain as love created me. Show me my reality that God placed in my mind forever. And breathe that in. yourself in this situation, I still remain exactly as love created me. I'm still complete. I'm still whole. I'm still wholly loving and wholly lovable. I'm still innocent. I am only love. And now I want you to imagine in your mind's eye sharing that into this situation, this relationship where you had been feeling attacked or crucified. Imagine yourself being in that situation or relationship, knowing that you are only love. And that is forever true. Nothing can change that. Imagine yourself demonstrating your own perfect immunity in that situation or in that relationship. What might you be doing? What might you be saying? How might you be radiating? How might you be feeling? What might that person look like to you? And above all, how might you be feeling in that situation if you were remembering your own perfect immunity and were teaching only that? Your resurrection. That is your rebirth. That is your reawakening. Imagine yourself in this situation or this relationship where what is forever true in your mind dawns upon your mind. And nothing external may have changed, but you are free. You are free. Free from anger. Free from guilt. Free from fear. You are reborn into yourself. And breathe it in. Breathe it in. Enjoy. Enjoy correct perception. Enjoy being awake. Beautiful. And to that we say amen. Thank you, God, for that. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. Yeah, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for helping me to experience some rebirth tonight. I really needed that.
It's great. Well,
I could have had a rebirth. All right. I appreciate you guys. I appreciate you guys watching and being around.
Thank you.
Thank you.